birth, and it is in the human birth this cessation of karma is possible. Then instruction of dharma will enable to do so, and also belief in dharma, if one has the propensity for that, and energy for self-control, that is action. Varieties of creatures born in this samsara are born in this samsara. The privileged devas are gifted with various virtues, descend on earth, enjoy human life, obtain true knowledge by the pure merit acquired in former lives. Man should apply himself, self-control, penance, shake off remnants of karma, become eternal siddha. Maybe the royal figures here is a reference to those specially privileged devas which are referred to in this lecture. Here you will see what I call allegory. Allegories may sound simple, juxtapositions, but normally Vishwas ji will agree, very often no one takes this seriously. It's an interesting phenomenon in Indian art, saying something through allegory. But we have to recognize that fact. Lecture 4, it's essential be always watchful, like a Varuna bird. Reject pramada, keep and adopt a pramada. Pramada means carelessness, negligence, inattention, and also intoxication, drunkenness. Maybe the reclining figure represents that. A man full of pramada is surrounded with darkness. Perhaps the sleeping man represents the pramadi in the painting. Though others sleep, you may be awake. Be always alert till you win the enlightenment. Be always watchful like a Varuna bird, which is a bird with its mythical bird. Imaginary word, two heads or two necks and three legs. Two heads implies that he is able to see in all directions. He is, I think our Indian word, chokana, keep off delusion, remove pride, do not practice deceit, give up greed, keep his results from idleness, procrastination. Again, this reclining face figure would be idleness, procrastination. There is also added this one line, but we don't see any objection here. People accumulate money, consider it as amrita, and so on. Life is short, old age is inevitable. Lecture 5. Man caught in trap of disease. Again, we have this reclining figure here. Ignorant man attached to pleasure and amusement, caught in the trap of receipt. Carries out cruel actions. He is attacked by disease. Death against own will is that of ignorant man. Death with one's will, namely after holding fast, is that of wise man. He is calm and peaceful at the time of his death. So these two types of death are mentioned, of which we will see allegorical representation in another one. I think there is a reference to family, pleasures. The music and dance often refers to worldly pleasures in such illustrations. A brief, a synoptic reference to worldly pleasures. Because we'll also see reference to the fact that one shouldn't respond to this pleasure, which is a little odd. Lecture 7, the goat is fed with much care till the guest arrives. When its head is cut to offer the goat to the guest at the feast. This is the painting. Lecture 7. The goat is here also in the allegory, and it thematically relates to previous one also. two types of death. The goat is fed with much care till the guest arrives, when its head is cut to offer the goat to the guest at the feast. The ignorant man enjoys riches and pleasures, women, drinking, liquor, killing living beings, and so forth, who under the burden of karma will grieve at the hour of death, like the goat. Lower tier, calf. The calf is complaining to mother, so you see the two, that he is fed with dry grass in comparison with the goat. The mother explained the fate of the goat. So the goat enjoying or being fed with good rich food is compared with the orderly how a man lives, and doesn't realize that ultimately he is going to meet a violent death. This frame also relates to lecture 7. This man enjoying riches. So you have almost the, you know, Raja, the king, palace, queen, and other luxurious aspects. And then he is contrasted with a monk. The king increases his capital, that is power. The virtuous monk cheerfully attains the state of gods. A monk does not love even those who love him. A monk should cast aside all hatred and attachment to pleasures. Lecture 9. King Nami with Indra. Now these are what I call drishtant. Persons who suddenly get inspiration and want to become sannyasi. The pravarja of King Nami and dialogue with Indra is the theme of this lecture 9. King Nami remembered his past life about his King Nami with the queen. And then again we have King Nami and Indra in the garb of Brahmin, and there is an argument. King Nami remembered his past life and belonging to the world of gods, decided to become a shamana. After enjoying all kinds of pleasures, he decided to renounce them. Indra appears as a Brahmin and begins argument. Your palace is on fire. Do what is the true duty of a kshatriya. Build palaces, punish thieves, bring to subjugation all other princes, multiply your wealth. Nami denies all this. Man should conquer himself. And other arguments, other reply he gives to Indra. And then Indra acknowledges that, Nami is a great saint. I have, not brought in all that long discussion. But the discussion about the worldly power and the advantages or the fruits of being a monk. Lecture 11. Here, the artist says, I have already mentioned this image. This is the Tirthankara in seated Padmasana. But it represents moksha. The standing is keval gyan, like enlightenment. And he still has to teach to the humanity. And then afterwards, when he receives moksha, the representation is like this. So most seated Jain images would mean Tirthankara as the one who has achieved the siddha, who has achieved the moksha. So that is how this image is put there. And then the attempt in this chapter is the train it took, the learned monk is compared with certain animals for their great qualities. So the arrested animals, although the animals are not, they're shown in small size, they should have been more conspicuous. But I have seen one or two other illustrations where animals are very boldly drawn. Trained horse exceeds all other horses in speed. So that kind of horse. So a learned monk is compared with that kind of horse. Similarly, elephant cannot be resisted. He has such strength. That is another, allegorical comparison. Then strong-necked bull is a fine sight. So a learned monk is compared with that. Then lion with sharp fangs is superior to all animals. Is another comparison. Shakra as king of gods is also a comparison. I could not match this. Now this here we have a story. this is monk Harikesh Bala and Princess Bhadra. Harikesh Bala, born in a Chandala family. Brahmin boys were beating the emaciated monk. He became a monk. And also it is significant that he is a Chandala. So the Brahmin boys are beating him. And then the princess, as you see here, came to his rescue by claiming that once she had been offered to him in marriage and he refused to accept her in marriage earlier because he wanted to be a monk. So even then she is praising him that he is a noble and austere ascetic. We can see these boys here and maybe they are the boys who were throwing stones at him and so on. The artist hasn't shown the emaciated figure, but because he is referred to as noble monk, so I think the artist has preferred this very graceful, very beautiful. Often you will see in Jain painting, we do get this very well proportionate depiction either of the, of course in this case Kayat Sarga, but by wrapping the monk's dress, it is supposed to be, I mean, we have to read it as the monk. But in this lecture, there is criticism of some Hindu practices. I have not gone into that. such as, because Brahmins were actually having a yajna, and so they didn't also want this monk, who is obviously Jain monk, and also Chandala, to come near the yajna and so on. So true nature of yajna, tapa is the agni, actually agni, tapa is the agni, not the actual fire. The soul is the place of tapa, etc. These are the notions expounded in this. There are indications here and there of showing superiority of Jainism or Hinduism. Lecture 13, we have Chitta and Sambhuta, who are two, maybe brothers, or two such persons who have been born same time and they meet in whichever form they are born. Or sometimes they are born as Sambhuta, monarch of Kampilya, Chitta as monk. Brothers in former birth, separated but met again, slaves in next birth, antelopes in next birth, geese in another birth. You can see the antelopes below. Both discuss karma. King prefers pleasure, monk prefers austerities. So king and monk, the two distinct images are there. King went to hell, monk obtained moksha. The condition of the, there is also a reference to the helpless condition of the body after death, when this helpless corpse is placed on the funeral, fire pile, which is then lighted with fire. So the something within the content of this chapter, one can associate that fire with that portion. This is lecture 15. Again, this is a drishtant. King Ishukara and his wife Kamalavati, Purohit Bhrugu and his wife Vashishti, and their two sons. Below you see the two youngsters who could be the sons of Bhrugu and Vashishti. Six souls, often reborn and connected with each other as husband, wife, father, son. Lower tier, two sons of Bhrugu want to become monks. Critical arguments against Brahmanism. Sons announce, everything is transitory. We take no delight in domestic life. We wish to become Shramanas. The father tried to persuade them not to do so. Study Vedas, feed priests, enjoy life with your wives. Place your sons as on the head of house, and then you may depart to the forest. The sons are convinced. The sons finally convince the parents, who also renounce their worldly pleasures, and they reached perfection. When Kamalavati came to know that Bhrugu and his children had renounced family life, she began dialogue with Raja Ishukara. Even if you own the entire world, all the things will not be sufficient to satisfy your Krishna. At the same time, at the time of death, only the Dharma can come to your rescue. She proposed that they should also accept the life of Shraman. Lecture 15. The true monk. Steadfast monk should be a model of righteousness, neither rash nor passionate, who practices self-discipline, who meditates on the soul, who does not hurt anybody. And here, in the Kalpasutra painting, the Gautama Ganadhara, that is the principal... Yes, I can stop anytime. In the Kalpasutra paintings, the imagery of Gautama Ganadhara is depicted like this. And so, for perfect monk or true monk, in this chapter, this imagery has been taken. And in, there is a second frame of this imagery, where the Kayat Sarga, I have already mentioned that posture, is shown. Kayat Sarga of Mahavir. In the life events of Mahavir, it is mentioned that some people put nails into his ears, pointed, steel rods into his ears. Various kinds of tortures are mentioned there, and still he bears that. And so this is one such episode shown there. So, torture by avoids men, women, practices austerities, subdues his senses, does not pay attention to artists of all sorts, princes, that is, persons with power and prestige. So, there is this small panel of dance figures to illustrate that idea. I mean, your suggestion is good. I am only trying to show how difficult it is to the concepts related to spirituality. How difficult it will be to represent in the painting, and it is those points only I am trying to draw attention. There is a reference to 10 conditions of perfect chastity. Sudharva Swami telling Jambu Swami, he heard the following discourse from the Venerable Mahavir. Not to sleep where women, cattle and those without gender come frequently. Not to converse with women. Not to sit on the same seat. Should not look at, contemplate the charms and beauties of women. not to hear giggling, singing of women, not to recall pleasures enjoyed with the women. We notice this reclining figure with woman and child would refer to the grihastha stage of, or grihastha or grihastha stage of the monk. Not to wear ornaments or adorn his body, should abstain from five pleasant things: smell, taste, sound, seeing, touching, etc. In the lower tier, the monk is holding in his hand some object which is worth admiring. That is, even such thing should not be done. This is a lesson, lecture 18. King Sanjay hunting. Sanjay, the king of Kampilya, went for hunting, chased deer on horseback. He killed deer, died in the presence of a monk meditating on the law. The king bowed before the monk. And the king arrives there. The king bowed before the monk and asked to be forgiven. The monk begins discourse: "O king, grant safety to others also. In this transient world, why are you addicted to frivolity?" Later, the king also adopted monkhood. I'll just take up two or three chapters. This is a story which is shown in three frames, and it's a story of Aristonemy, but here the emphasis is slightly different. Neminath was to marry Rajimati, but when he went to the place where the marriage was to be celebrated, he heard animals crying, and he asked why these animals are crying. He said they are going to be slaughtered for to celebrate, to have the feast for your marriage. So that is the moment when he decides to become sannyasi or take diksha. So rejecting Rajimati. Now we have, on top is Arishtanemi. And then he becomes a monk. Here Rajimati also becomes a sadhvi. She takes diksha. The third one is very interesting. Here, it seems that Neminath's brother had earlier been offered Rajimati, but Rajimati had rejected him and preferred Neminath. So that person became a monk. And when Rajimati has become a sadhvi, she is climbing Girnar mountain, and it suddenly rains, her clothes get wet. She enters a cave, and seeing that it is very dark, but probably nobody is there, she removes the clothes and tries to dry the clothes. When she heard this voice, who was none other than the other brother whom she had rejected. So he offers now, why should we become monk, or we may become monk later on, let us marry and enjoy the worldly life. But she, that is, here we have a female monk talking about celibacy to a wavering monk. Here there is a reference in this one to the importance that in Hinduism is given to yajna and so on, and animal sacrifice, which is being criticized. I find pictorially this very interesting, qualities of correct behavior, reference to behavior towards superiors, the there is a 24 hours routine mentioned here. Divide the day in four parts and devote to study, meditation, vidhik tour, and again study. Perform kayotsanga is repeatedly prescribed in this chapter. The monk should praise the perfected saints, Tirthankaras. Such correct behavior practiced by many souls enabled them to cross the ocean of samsara. So the artist has ingeniously juxtaposed yogic positions of Tirthankaras to explain this. Here again there is a parable in lecture 27. This is bull who is pulling the cart. If there is a good bull, he will smoothly cross through the jungle to the forest, which is like a good monk completing the life on this world. But if it is a bad bull, what the bad bull will do? He will have erratic behavior, go forward, backward, or leave the road. He will jump agitatingly or remain stubbornly still or just sleeps. So this bad bull is compared with bad monk. So bad pupils, lack of zeal, make objections, point to imagined difficulties, averse to begging of food, arrogance, anger, and also two fighting monks are shown below. So this I find it one of the most interesting. There is one last one I will show. There is this 34th lesson, the six leshas. Leshas are elsewhere, like in the on the right is the Sangrahani Sutra illustration. That is another text called Sangrahani Sutra, where the lesha concept is illustrated. And the same lesha concept is also illustrated in the Uttaradhyayana Sutra. But Uttaradhyayana Sutra doesn't use the notions of colors which are part of this theme. So that is why I have juxtaposed the one on the right to show here this artist hasn't used the notion of the colors in the same way as otherwise elsewhere in the depiction of six. The six leshas produced by karma affecting the soul. They are actually, lesha is the term for behavior and psychological personality traits. So this is an insight into that. So bad lesha, one side is bad lesha, there are three types, another is good lesha, again three types. And the same you will see three figures on the left side, three figures on the right side. The left side are bad leshas. So what is explained in this chapter, you see more of it in that illustration than in this illustration. Black color. So this is a figure in black color. For the black, Krishna is used. He is cruel and violent. And blue color. Actually, the black color, cruel, violent, it is the extreme end of the character. You have very good here, experience, and you will have the worst character. So this is the worst, cruel, violent. Blue, neela, the middle one, envy, anger, selfish, shameless, love of enjoyment. Gray, kapota, below, dishonest, deceiver. On the right, good leshas, red, tenjo. He is humble, well-disciplined, sympathetic, self-controlled. And then yellow color, you see in the middle, on the right, Padma. He is not much angry, occasionally gets angry. He is able to control himself, calm. The third, white, Shukla, engages in meditation, subdues his senses, dispassionate in position of five samitis and three muktis. I'll read my last four lines. Last four lines. I am aware that this treatise of Jainism focuses on the extreme limits of austerities required of a monk, and eventually how, having reached the heights of spirituality, such a being breaks the bonds of karma and achieves moksha. However, there are quite a number of values which are worth inculcating, at least in order that one is considered a good human being.
Thank you.
Many thanks to Dr. Parikh for the introduction. They are altogether unknown text to us. It would have been better if you could enlighten us about the technicalities of these paintings, the use of color, the use of materials, etc. We think you may add that after the session is open. No? Thank you very much.